Roger and Carmel Arturi Phillips, I can really say I think you are a couple devoted to miniature painting and to miniatures. Not only being collectors yourself, you're also researching, you're publishing, you have published several books on miniature painting. You're estimated advisors to several museums, you are members, honorary members of several societies, among them the Royal Miniature Society, and we are very glad to have you here with us again as 3 years ago when you were also here in Celle. They will get us now into the oeuvre of John Cox Dillmann Engelhardt, who for a long time has been in the shadow of his uncle George Engelhardt. Unlike other artists of his time, John Engelhardt was born into a wealthy family, the only son and heir, and it was never necessary for him to earn a living. Most of you won't have seen this early self-portrait of him, which is still in his family's collection. His given names reflected the source of his inheritance, both from family members and from his father's first childless marriage. Hence he was christened John Cox Dillmann Engelhardt. After reviewing the artist's surviving records, we're going to show that this much misunderstood and underrated artist was a child prodigy, and after inheriting the fortunes of four family members as a young man, he went on to earn another fortune with his own talent. John Engelhardt went to school for 10 years, leaving at the age of 14. Already with artistic proficiency, at 14 he joined his uncle, George Engelhardt, part-time at his London studio and continued to work there on and off for the following 3 years. He started earning money almost immediately, painting his first independent miniature at the age of 15. At the age of 17, his parents decided to leave Kew, which was the place where the original Engelhardts first settled, and take a house in one of the popular artist quarters in central London. Noisy, dirty, smelly London must have come as quite a shock to them. Although he was only 17, their son's talent was already evident, and this close-knit family wanted to support John in his starting his career as a professional miniature painter. We'll just pause a moment on this wonderful portrait of his father, which was done when he was 19. It's an extraordinary polished work for a 19-year-old, and you see the detail in his father's striped vest, the bulge of his stomach, the wonderful hand, and that sort of kindly, genial look which reflects what John thought about his father.
Now this is an extraordinary portrait by John again of his uncle. So John's father is the eldest brother of George Engelhardt, the miniature painter. And this is the only proper portrait we have of George Engelhardt. George's own self-portraits were merely profile portraits, most of them profile drawings. It's noteworthy that John Engelhardt started his professional career at the age of 17. George, his uncle, started his career at 25. In addition, John's career overlapped his uncle's by 12 years, during which time George was arguably in his finest period. And yet the young John, his earnings eclipsed his uncle's by 100%. One of the legacies passed on by George and continued by John was the practice of making a pencil sketch and using this to transfer the image onto the ivory and also to use it at a later date to make another copy. This practice was evident with both artists, and hundreds of their pencil sketches still survive today, kept in folders by their descendants. Unlike George, John was prepared to travel outside the capital to find work, as far away as the area we know as the Midlands, around Birmingham. He rode there on horseback, took lodgings, and advertised his services with a printed card. George's speed of work and his output are legendary, but John must have been just as quick and efficient in order for his earnings to exceed his uncle's by such an extent. This is a very interesting miniature, together with its pencil drawing of the four Woolly Boys. And this was done early in John's career. The actual miniature is in the collection of the Victoria and Albert Museum. What's particularly interesting is that in the pencil sketch that we see here, the fourth boy, the youngest, is turned around, but obviously the artist decided that he wasn't satisfied with that, or perhaps the client wasn't, and in the final picture we see the young boy face on. The mystery is, where is all the work of John Engelhardt? And we don't have any answers. There are a number of possibilities. When he signed, John Engelhardt nearly always signed on the backing sheet. We're showing here a very rare signature on the front, but these are so rare that most people would never have seen them. Having the signature on the backing sheet, maybe that certain miniatures have never been opened and the work has not been attributed to him. Another possible reason is that he used a lot of gum, particularly in the coats and clothes of his sitters, and this tended to crack, and perhaps miniatures were discarded because they were damaged in this way. We don't know. John has never been categorized in the top tier or even second tier of miniature painters during his time. The first decade of his career, he was a contemporary of famous miniature painters like John Smart, Richard Cosway, as well as his uncle George Engelhart, William Wood, and other well-known artists like Andrew Robertson. There was also the question about his capabilities that caused a lot of critics to criticize his work. There is some uncertainty in his rendering of the Engelhart Manor. Graham Reynolds. And he is misled by a desire to construct allegorical and mythical compositions on ivory for which he was not sufficiently equipped. Graham Reynolds. His earlier works were in the manner of his uncle. His later works, like this, are among his worst. Basil Long. And even George Williamson criticized his colouring, which as he advanced in life became far hotter and less refined than his uncle's ever was, and lacked the dainty lightness that George Engelhart possessed in so great a degree. Sometimes people have a perception that John Engelhart was an artist working somewhere in the Victorian era. This is a misconception. Actually, the whole of his career was spent during the time of George IV, as Prince of Wales, as Prince Regent, and as King. By the time that King George IV had died in 1830, John had already retired. That was John's mother, actually. We ought to just sort of point it out. John's mother, a most amazing portrait there. You just look at the detail. And she does look very worn, poor lady. She had 9 children, and only 4 got anywhere near adulthood, and then one died at 21, leaving only 3. So she has every right to look like this. When George Engelhart retired in 1813, John found it necessary to advertise to his clients that he was still working. This showed that he had his own reputation as a miniature painter. This is a particularly fine miniature, and if we look at some of the detail, even the little whiskers by his sideburns, John has shown that his morning shave has missed, and the incredible detail in the eyes and the colours. And if you notice, the hair is nothing like the hair that George Engelhart did, much finer and more detailed and textured. Like George Engelhart, John invested his surplus income in buy-to-let London property. After his marriage, he bought a country home in East Acton, west of London. As a young man, he followed typical young man pursuits of going to the races, playing cards, going to music festivals, having a meal out. These were never pastimes that one could ever imagine his Uncle George indulging in. The relationship between uncle and nephew was one of respectful deference. There's nothing to indicate that it was anything more than that. However, his relationship with his parents was one of devotion on both sides. In his journal, which he kept and which the family still have, and he logged the first 45 years of his life retrospectively, probably written up between 1823 and 1829. He details a lot about his career and frequently alludes to his ill health. No causes for his ill health are given, but various physicians are consulted. His family now believe that he suffered from extreme anxiety. The story of this anxiety is really told in these two self-portraits, 20 or so years apart. The anxious young man with his hand clutched to his forehead, perhaps a little reticent about what the future might hold. The middle-aged man in the pencil drawing, quite gaunt, weighed down with cares. Clearly, John's cares were not financial. Although a very wealthy man, he lived quite modestly, considering his wealth, not too ostentatiously. The family lived in a handsome house, and John enjoyed simple things like working in his own garden, attending the local church, and being involved in local affairs. After a lifetime, an adult lifetime of ill health, John and his wife Mary decided to take a tour abroad for 6 months on doctor's advice. John's social set was not drawn from the aristocracy, but from the professional and merchant classes, as were most of his clientele. This wonderful portrait was one of the few that fetched probably the sort of sum that his work deserves at auction. So John and his wife took this trip abroad. They'd never been to Europe before, for 6 months, leaving their children with a relative. And on John's return, he decided to give up his career as a miniature painter after practicing for 27 years. The trip was such a success, John planned another European adventure, but this time taking the whole family and leaving England for about 3 years. His youngest son, Gardner, was only 7 years old. The travelogue that the artist kept recording their trip was illustrated by 250 watercolours, which the artist and all the members of his family did. On their return to England, and John taking up his life as a retired gentleman, he lived another 30-odd years. When East Acton became too busy and populated, the family moved further out to the spa town of Tunbridge Wells, where they lived until John died at the age of 78. Only one of his children had children of his own, and John did not become a grandfather until the age of 76, 2 years before his death. Finally, how good an artist is John Engelhardt? How does his work compare with his more illustrious contemporaries? Does he deserve the title genius? We've got a few examples to show you. You can make your own comparison. George Engelhardt, in his later and probably finest period. Richard Cosway, in his heyday. John Engelhardt, at the start of his career. The amazing John Smart. Or Tisley, for those who prefer continental. John Engelhardt. William Wood. And you can still see he uses those crazy dots and dashes right into the centre of the eye. The famous Augustine. John Engelhardt.
Thank you, Roger and Carmela, for this really brilliant compensation for John Cox Dillmann Engelhardt. Thank you.